Hi, very good evening. So today we'll focus on intensifying screens from radiology. So it's around 10, right? So 10 p.m. So we'll start our session as soon as possible. A very good evening, all of you. So we have, in fact, created a point-and-shoot test today from the same topic, intensifying screens, at around 4 or 5 p.m. this afternoon. I even posted an update. So try to complete the test as soon as possible. We'll try to cover the rest of the topics which we haven't mentioned in the test. And also in the entire process of this discussion, we'll try to have an overview of intensifying screens, right? So I hope you guys are ready. Once again, a very good evening. So we'll start with some discussion. So before we start, let me know if it is streaming fine, and also let me know if you have any issues with my audio, right? Do let me know as soon as possible. Okay, we'll start with our first question. What do you mean by intensifying screens? So as the name itself depicts, it has something to do with intensification. So what is the function of an intensifying screen? Yes, Soumya? Yeah, thank you for the feedback. So what are intensifying screens? What do you mean by intensification? What exactly is happening in intensifying screens? Hi Mubashira, good evening. I mean, this is not morning, right? You said good morning. Okay. So as you know, as the name itself depicts, intensifying screens are nothing but screens which intensify. These are very much sensitive to X-rays, and they emit visible light upon exposure to X radiation. So an intensifying screen is sensitive to X-ray. This is very, very important. On being exposed to X-ray, they fluoresce and emit visible light. And the intensity of this fluorescence depends upon the energy of radiation which is falling on these intensifying screens. So scientists have discovered that there are certain inorganic salts, including phosphorus, which actually fluoresce or emit light whenever X-rays fall onto them. So based on that concept, we have these intensifying screens. Also make a note that these intensifying screens are not used exclusively in radiology, but they are used in combination with the so-called screen films. So we have something called as screen films. So what do you mean by screen film, and in what way is it different from a conventional X-ray film? So what's the difference between a screen film and a conventional X-ray film, which we use in our routine, our day-to-day clinical practice? Yes, Srish, Richa, Prithu. Hi, Basit. Exactly. So screen films are those films which are sensitive to visible light but not X-rays. So these screen films are used in conjunction with these intensifying screens. So it's very simple. The intensifying screens are placed on either side of a screen film, as you can see. So the black one is a film, screen film. On either side you have intensifying screens. So when X-rays fall, so they fall onto these intensifying screens or intensifying films, and then they emit visible light onto these screen films. As I mentioned, screen films are sensitive to visible light but not X-rays. So the image processing happens, and then we see formation of latent image and ultimately diagnostic image formation. Also make a note that silver halide crystals, which we are all familiar with, they are not only sensitive to X-rays but they are also sensitive to blue light, UV light, as well as green light. So this forms the basis of screen films. So these screen films and intensifying screens are used in conjunction, especially in extraoral radiography, right, to achieve diagnostic images. So this is brief introduction pertaining to intensifying screens. It's very simple, very interesting, and very important at the same time. So we'll start with our first question. What is the objective of intensifying screen? If I ask you this question, what would be your straightforward answer? What is the objective? You're not talking about the functions. Try to be specific to the question. What is the objective of intensifying screen? I'm sorry, you have any streaming issues? Yeah, if you have any streaming issues, just try to reopen the app if you're using the mobile, or if you think the audio and video is not, they're not in line, then try to refresh the page. So the question is, what is the objective of intensifying screen? As all of you rightly mentioned, the objective is to reduce patient X-ray dosage, because as clearly mentioned in White and Farrow, these intensifying screens are almost 10 to 60 times more sensitive. They are almost 10 to 60 times more sensitive. As a result, the amount of radiation which we give to the patient is drastically being reduced. So these intensifying screens are 10 to 60 times more sensitive to X-rays than screen film alone. That's the reason why they're called as intensifying screens. As simple as that, as you all rightly mentioned. So the objective of these intensifying screens is to reduce patient X-ray dosage or exposure. Wonderful. Okay, now if you look into the next one. So are these intensifying screens in combination with screen films used in extraoral radiography, intraoral radiography? Both? None. So which one would you choose? Intensifying screens in combination with screen films are used in extraoral, intraoral, both? None. Okay, why are they used only in extraoral radiography but not in form of periapical films or occlusal films? Why are they not used in intraoral radiography? You're right. These are used only in extraoral radiography. What could be the reason? Yeah, we can prepare films, screen films of smaller size. Film size should never be an issue. It has something to do with the resolution of image. Yes, Divya? Srija, Ramya, wonderful. So it has something to do with the resolution. The resolution of the image system or the image which is being created is very inferior, that it's not of diagnostic value. That's the reason why they're not used in intraoral radiography. Right? So that's very, very important again. Now, what is the composition? So intensifying screens along with screen films, what is the composition of these intensifying screens? Yes, Prerna seems to be lightning fast today. Base reflecting layer, phosphorus layer, protective layer. You do not have a separate reflecting layer, but base at times can be reflective. Depends upon the material we use. Base can be reflective or non-reflective. Yes, Rukeya? So as you can see here, the top one is base. The green one, I think you can differentiate the colors, right? Yeah, I think it's clear. So the green one is phosphorus layer or phosphor layer. The red one is a protective coat. And the middle one is nothing but a screen film. As we discussed in the beginning, it's a screen film. And as I mentioned previously, the screen film is bounded by intensifying screens on either side. So you have an intensifying screen here and another intensifying screen here. So the components or the composition of intensifying screen includes base, phosphor layer and protective coat. So let's have some discussion pertaining to these layers. As Prerno, you mentioned that base is a reflective layer. So is it an advantage or disadvantage? So base, as the name itself indicates, it mechanically supports the rest of the layers. Right? It can be reflective or non-reflective. What if the base is reflective? What's the advantage and what's the disadvantage? Yes, Akriti, wonderful. So, if you see, if the base is reflective, so simple, the X-rays will be falling onto the intensifying screens, onto the phosphor layer, and from the phosphor layer, there will be dissipation of X radiation to visible light, and then there will be fluorescence. So, in this process, if the base is reflective, these visible rays are reflected back onto the phosphor layer. Right, which in turn magnifies the entire visible light production. So we have partly an advantage. It reflective layer helps in maximizing the amount of visible light that's being emitted. At the same time, as you rightly mentioned, because of reflection or re-reflection, there can be a degree of unsharpness, which is very, very important, right? So we have an advantage as well as disadvantage. It's not just the disadvantage. The advantage is nothing but the overall intensity of the visible light that's being produced increases, because it's as simple as that. When X-rays fall, phosphor layer fluoresces and releases visible light. This visible light exposes the screen film. If the base is reflective, so the visible light which is going outside also will be reflected back onto the screen film, which intensifies further. So that's one advantage you have. The disadvantage being that this reflection is in different directions, which can lead to some degree of unsharpness. Another take-home message, right? Okay, I hope it's clear. Now, we're talking about base. So we'll discuss about the thickness of base and protective coat a bit later. So what is this phosphor layer? So phosphor layer contains phosphor, inorganic salts like phosphor, along with rare earth elements like lanthanum and gadolinium, right? So these actually are sensitive to X-rays, and when exposed to radiation, they emit visible light, which is nothing but fluorescence. So what are the elements or materials which are added to this phosphor layer in order to increase the intensity of fluorescence? Can you name some materials? Yes, Rukia, you well said. You say reflective base layer increases light emission. Good. At the same time, there can be unsharpness. Wonderful. Yes, Amara. Thulium, niobium, and terbium. So we have thulium, niobium and terbium, which can be added in order to increase the overall reflectivity. Wonderful. Whereas lanthanum and gadolinium are rare earth elements which are found along with a phosphor layer. Yes. Thulium, niobium and terbium. So these are some of the materials which are added to phosphor layer. And if you look into protective coat, so protective coat, as the name itself indicates, it provides protection to phosphor layer and also provides a surface to maintain cleanliness. Only when it provides a surface, it can be cleaned, and this cleaning enables us to remove any debris or any scratch marks, etc. Right? If at all there is any debris on the intensifying screen, that would result in light spot on a radiograph or dark spot on a radiograph, which is more appropriate answer. If at all, I'm repeating the question, if at all there is any debris on the intensifying screen, or any scratch mark, it would result in light spot on a radiograph or dark spot on a radiograph. Simple. It has to be a light spot because debris or scratch mark eliminates the function of intensifying screen. As a result, the part of screen film corresponding to this debris doesn't get exposed to visible light, which is reflected in the form of light spots or a radiograph. Wonderful. Okay, so these are some of the layers and composition of intensifying screen. So base, phosphor layer and protective coat. And coming to the nature of materials, base is nothing but a kind of polyester plastic. Phosphor layer, inorganic material which is bounded by polymeric material again. And you have this protective coat which is a polymeric material again, which has to be tough and it has to be protective in nature. Now, coming to the thickness of base and protective coat. So certain numericals which you need to memorize. So what is the thickness of base and what is the thickness of protective coat of intensifying screens? Do make a note whether it's in millimeters or microns. Often in options we tend to get confused. So you have to be very much precise, specific, and you have to be damn sure before you answer or mark a question. The thickness of base is 0.25 millimeters and the thickness of protective coat less than or equal to 15 microns, as you all rightly mentioned. Less than or equal to 15 microns is the thickness of protective coat, whereas the thickness of base is 0.25 millimeters. Yes, wonderful. Now, moving on to the last subtopic, or rather I should say last question related to intensifying screens, which is the most important. And we have a lot of concept in this. What are various types of intensifying screens based on speed? I'm even telling you the criteria. So what are various types of intensifying screens based on speed? Yes. So based on speed, we have high speed, low speed, and medium speed intensifying screens, or fast, slow, or medium, or high, low, or medium. You can use whatever words are appropriate because they're all carrying the same meaning. So what is the difference between these fast screen films or fast intensifying screens, slow intensifying screens, and medium intensifying screens? Can you name at least two or three differences between these? So all these classification or categories are based on these three parameters: thickness, size of the silver halide crystals or phosphor crystals, rather I can say silver halide crystals will be that of screen film, I'm sorry, phosphor crystals, and the definition. So based on these three criteria, we have fast, slow, and medium speed films. Wonderful. So as you all rightly mentioned, Rukia says large phosphor crystals in fast, Ramya, Bhagyashri, Induleka, Mubashira, Kriti, yes. So can you explain me why in case of fast screens, we have larger crystals. What is the correlation between the size of the crystals and the speed of the film? But before that, what do you mean by speed of a film? Coming to the very basic question, what is speed in terms of radiology? What do you mean by speed? Yes, Divya. So fast screens have thicker phosphorus layer and they have larger crystals, but poor definition. The reverse is true in case of slow screens, where there is lesser thickness of phosphor layer, smaller crystals, but high definition. That's the reason why slow screen or low speed screens are called as high definition screens. See, speed is nothing but the amount of radiation that's required to produce a radiograph of standard density. So, in order to have good speed, we need larger crystals, because larger crystals are efficient in converting X-rays into visible rays in case of intensifying screens. So, whether you have a greater thickness of phosphor layer or larger crystals in phosphor layer, there will be efficient conversion of X-rays into visible light, hence the speed is very good, high speed, which means low dosage to the patient. As we discussed, speed is nothing but the amount of radiation that's required to produce an image of standard density, a radiographic image of standard density. So that's the relation we have. And if you look into slow speed, you have lesser thickness or smaller crystals, where the speed is less because of the size of the crystals, which is small. So that's one important parameter. And how is it related to definition? When we say fast screens, we say poor definition, or the resolution of the image, resultant image is very poor. But in case of slow screens, they are high definition, or the resolution is much better. So what is the relation between the speed and definition? Exactly, Ramya. Ramya has a point due to scattering. Very simple. When you have a larger crystal size, there will be more scattering, so the definition is less. When you have smaller crystals, lesser scattering, so there will be resultant high definition. So this concept is very important. So we have intensifying screens based on high, low, or medium speed, and this categorization is based on the following parameters: thickness, crystal size, and definition. To summarize briefly, in case of high speed intensifying screens, the thickness of phosphor layer is more, the size of the crystals is more, and the definition is very poor. In case of low speed, the thickness is less, crystal size is less, and definition is more. We have discussed the reasons now. Just remember the basic format here. When the crystal size is more, it is said to be having greater speeds, because larger crystals or higher thickness of the material, more efficient conversion of X-rays to visible light. Again, coming to definition of the image, larger crystal size, more scattering, poor definition. So, to summarize, high-speed films, they have higher thickness of phosphor layer, larger crystal size, but the definition is low. I hope I'm not confusing you, right? It doesn't matter, even if you don't remember all of this, just try to get the concept, you will automatically remember. You try to correlate between the size of the crystals and speed, size of the crystals and definition, you'll obviously remember all this classification and the concept behind it. I hope it's clear, right? So that pertains to various types of intensifying screens. Yeah. Yes, Anjali? Yeah, inversely proportional. You can frame your own mnemonic in order to simplify the concept, or easier way of understanding things. So this is in brief various specific points pertaining to intensifying screens, along with that try, attend and complete your point and shoot test as soon as possible, and you will have a complete overview of the topic intensifying screens. So before we conclude, I'll summarize once again in brief all that we have discussed so far. So intensifying screens, as the name itself indicates, their intensification process, they are 10 to 60 times more sensitive to X-rays than screen films. Hence they are called as intensifying screens. And these intensifying screens, the objective is to reduce X-ray doses to patient, right? So that's the main objective. So these intensifying screens are used in conjunction with screen films. So when they are used in conjunction with screen films, we create an image receptor system wherein X-rays are being converted into visible rays, and the screen film is sensitive to these visible rays, thereby producing a resultant diagnostic image. And various other important parameters. Objective, as we discussed, to reduce patient X-ray dosage. And they're used exclusively in extraoral radiography, which includes cephalometric projections, panoramic projections, or skull projections. So that's the meaning of extraoral projections. But they're not used intraorally as occlusal films or therapeutic films because of issues with resolution, as you all rightly mentioned. And then composition, we are seeing base, phosphor layer, protective coat. So each one has its own parameters. They're basically plastic materials, except for phosphor layer, which is inorganic, containing various rare earth elements like lanthanum and gadolinium. Along with that, certain materials like thulium, niobium and terbium are added to intensify or to increase the intensity of visible light which is being created in the process of fluorescence. And the thickness, numericals are also very important. Thickness of base in intensifying screens is 0.25 millimeters. Thickness of protective coat is less than or equal to 15 microns. And based on speed, we have different types of intensifying screens. Fast screens, slow screens, medium screens. So medium screens try to balance the speed at the same time definition, right? The concept here is very simple. High speed screens, they have higher thickness and larger crystals, so because of which there is greater speed, efficient conversion of X-rays into visible light. At the same time, because of greater scattering, because of larger crystal size, there is loss in definition. So to simply put, high speed films, they have good speed but poor definition. Low speed films or high definition films, also called as high definition films, they have low speed but higher definition. Because of low speed, we need to increase patient radiation dosage. So as simple as it is. So try to get the concept. You need not worry about memorizing or by-hearting these relations, whether it's directly proportional or inversely proportional. It creates havoc. It will be simple now, but after a few days or the time when you're giving exam, what if you get confused between directly or inversely proportional? So I don't remember concepts in that way, and I advise my students the same. So you have a concept there, trying to achieve some kind of correlation between the crystal size and speed, crystal size and definition, it will be easy for you to remember. I hope it's clear. Yes, Komal, I have just done that. I think I've given you the entire summary of all that we have discussed so far. So you have any further confusion or you need further clarity, do let me know. Or you can drop a mail at proudtobeanindustry@gmail.com. Okay. So we'll conclude. It's been 30 minutes, around 30 minutes, so we shall conclude our session now. And we'll see you again tomorrow in another live session. As I said, we'll have as many lives as possible, as many tests as possible, as many discussions as possible. Let's keep the remaining days as much lively as possible. So try to give your best, no matter where you are and what you're doing. It's all about giving your best each and every moment. We all have issues, we all have problems. The real challenge here is not the challenges we have, but our grit. We should be able to overcome our challenges and move forward with positivity and hope. That's the only way where we can achieve success. So wish you all the best. Love you all. And for any further queries, you can drop a mail anytime at proudtobeadentist@gmail.com. Fine. See you again tomorrow. Bye.